Real hot summer night.
Why do girls scream?
It was kind of a coming of age thing, you know. So I think to a degree it's a tribal thing.
I should say, run!
What's going to happen once they get there?
There's a girl hanging on the back of the car like this.
No, you can't have that. You can't have my tie. No, no.
I kissed towels. I kissed the doorknob. I kissed things I knew they were going to touch.
If I'm not the bull chasing them, they're chasing the bull.
Women, God, money, fame, fantastic.
And when they came on telly, I'd go, funny.
Like, wow, I could get used to this.
Why do girls scream?
Just such an energy release that you had that had been building up. So, you know, you just had to scream.
Waving's no good. It just doesn't seem enough. So you've got to go,
it almost became like a screaming contest.
It was just ridiculous. They just screamed from the time that we ran on stage till we ran off.
Ah! You know, then you'd be going, ah! You know, then somebody else, ah! And then somebody'd be fainting, ah!
When we first heard the screaming, we all stopped and went, wait a minute, what's going on here?
We thought the place was on fire or something was going on.
How else are you going to get your idol to even know you're alive?
That guitarist is gonna look at us and say, you.
Why do girls scream? Feels good.
I always say I'm not gonna scream, yeah, but I do. I heard you.
Sure, screaming feels good. Haven't some psychologists even prescribed it to chase away those inner demons and lift the spirits? They call that primal screaming. But what about the screaming of young teen girls, this hysterical shrieking for the hottest new pop idol or group that has become as much a fixture of the contemporary music scene over the years as a CD or a concert ticket? Oh, and don't let the tears, the swooning, and the uncontrollable sobbing and wailing fool you. They are having a simply wonderful time. But what's at the heart of all this madness and mayhem? Is this some sort of weird pagan ritual brought on by a full moon or some mesmerizing magic spell? Well, if you've ever wondered about what's behind this rapturous display of affection, fasten your seatbelts, because we're about to boldly go where few have dared to venture. Come with us as we take a fascinating journey through the mad, mad musical world of boy bands and girl power, bobby soxers and teeny boppers. Our mission? To get to the bottom of why young girls of apparently sound minds and rational outlook lose it completely in the presence of their musical heroes in a scream that is truly heard round the world.
It's completely universal. The whole just, that whole hysterical just madness is so interesting that it's not like they can, because they understand every word you're saying.
I'd love to sit there with my bass, and of course Donnie was the thing. And to see the craziness.
And there's a lot of excitement in it, and it's, they're out, and the music is stimulating, and they've been reading the magazines, and they have their favorites, and I think some of the feelings that they're having, maybe they don't completely understand yet.
What's up?
Hello!
Hi, everybody.
What's up? Oh! What's up? Oh!
What's going on?
For young girls, it's, again, the group thing. The more they scream, the louder they get, and the more they enjoy, you know, being with each other.
You know, you can add all kinds of layers of psychology and psychiatry and sociology and all that stuff, but the bottom line is that it has to do with the female's first opportunity to acknowledge her sexuality.
It was a freedom. It was an expansion. It was certainly a sexual energy. There's no question about that. And it was young girls desiring things for the first time in their lives, and it was an entire bust out from, you know, the norm that we were in.
I think in a way it's traditional to scream because everyone's done it since the Beatles or Cliff Richard in the early days, but it's just they want to let it all out. And I mean, I'll go and see a band now and I'll feel a bit emotional, and I mean, it's weird, but no matter what age you are, you've got to let it out somehow, I think.
It was just a self-expression, just a self-expression, because you knew that they couldn't see you up in the stands on the side of this place, but, you know, we knew that they could hear our screams, and that was, you know, how they knew that, you know, that we were there, and, you know, we were for them, and we're Beatle fans.
You become their boyfriend, and they have
They have pictures of you. They have stories about you.
Everyone who likes a boy band, they're like, I'm going to meet them. I want to meet them. I'm going to their concerts. It's like I was one of those people. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to meet them. I'm going to get a hug. I'm going to meet them.
It was a part of the process of being in that game, in show business. And if they didn't scream, you were in trouble.
Guys don't really scream, but there's just the natural fan response. That's just music. It's like music and like all these emotions that get built up, and it just comes out with, like, you know, hysteria. And I remember feeling that about, you know, certain artists like Aretha Franklin or meeting like Steven Tyler or Aerosmith and feeling like, oh my God, like, what am I doing? I'm shaking. And I, you know, what is it about this thing that is like freaking me out?
I mean, I used to go and see Pink Floyd and Led Zeppelin and things, and no, it never occurred to me to scream. Oh, you might want, yo, you know. Suppose that's a kind of male equivalent of a scream. Yeah, maybe I was a screamer. So what? Kill me.
It's like when you get a guy with 10 guys in a room for a hockey game, they're all screaming. If you got one by himself, he's sitting there. So it's the same thing. Well, you got 50,000 screaming teenagers, it's going to be contagious. Are you ready to party?
The screaming was for Frank Sinatra in the 40s. Into the 50s, it was Elvis Presley, a young swivel-hipped rabble-rouser who had them shrieking their allegiance to the once and future king of rock and roll. As the 50s gave way to the swinging 60s, a group of mop-top Brits from Liverpool took America and the rest of the world by storm.
And here they are, fresh from their triumphant appearances in the United States. 12,000 young Britons roar a welcome. Their shrieks rise in an awesome wave.
If we thought we'd seen the end of teen hysteria with the passing of Beatlemania, we couldn't have been more wrong, as the screaming continued unabated through the 70s and 80s.
How do you go from loving a record to just total pandemonium?
Certainly, I have great memories from that squirrely kind of teen, you know, with news stories of girls' jaws being locked open because they screamed all through the concert.
I actually won tickets on the radio to see Wham in Philly, and I screamed my head off, and I waved to George, and he waved back. And I was like, oh, my God!
By the turn of the millennium, the wacky world of pop celebrity was dominated by groups of high-stepping young men with soulful voices and cover boy good looks. They called them boy bands, and today the screams heard round the world are for a growing number of pop stars for whom choreography and vocal harmony rules.
We're here to see NSYNC, and we love them. No, they're so good. They're very talented, and they're all good-looking.
Very cute, and Lance is definitely the best, yeah, by far.
Like, hey, that's what happens at concerts. You're going to have, like, people screaming in your ear, but you just got to, like, join them.
The phenomenon of hysterical screaming by young female fans for their latest heartthrob had reached international proportions by the mid-60s as the Beatles emerged from England. The media dubbed it Beatlemania, and the symptoms were essentially the same whether the group was at home or abroad.
All is quiet, all is serene, but this is the lull before the storm. Thousands of Beatles fans are bedded down for the night to await the arrival of their heroes.
The anticipation was incredible. In my life, I don't know that there was anything as important as the Beatles.
Before the Beatles arrived, we knew what room they were in, so we were in their room.
When the dawn comes up like a teenage scream, the arrival of the froggy-voiced foursome is imminent.
The electricity, the tension, the way the kids were responding to the Beatles was something that we had never, ever seen before.
The cries of the crowd grow in pitch and volume, drowning out the whine of the jet engines.
I was behind the hugest cop you ever want to see, and all I did was pound the living daylights out of his back, but he didn't budge.
Some of the fences hold, others do not.
So then when George came, I rushed through the police's legs, I grabbed George's arm, and I screamed, George!
A minor miracle is mounted by the fact that there are no injuries spread among the near hysterical crowd.
I looked over, I saw Paul coming in, my favorite, so I crawled through the skirmish, grabbed both Paul's hands, and I went, Paul, hi! And he said, hello there, love.
This truly is a social document for our time.
As America reeled from the events surrounding the assassination of President Kennedy in late fall of 1963, news began to arrive from England of a new musical phenomenon that was taking the country by storm. By the time Beatlemania hit the shores of North America in 1964, the fans were more than ready to greet their new idols.
The box office opened
at 10 o'clock. We were the first ones in there, of course. So we got tickets, and we actually got tickets for lots of the kids in our school. They gave us their money, and we got tickets for a lot of them. So, but because we were the first ones in there, photographers came and they asked us to wave our money and scream. So we did. We waved our money and screamed, and that picture was in the paper. So when the nuns saw that, that was the next day. The nuns saw that. They took us out of class. They called a psychologist. They had us examined.
Michelle Finney, the young host of a kids' TV show, was given the dream assignment of interviewing the Fab Four as a member of the local press corps.
One of the local papers at the time approached me and said, we'd like you to interview them. And I sort of said, okay, I can do that. And I don't think I could speak for about 3 days. After I got back in my body and was able to speak, I think I was probably on the phone for another 3 days. And everybody, what did they eat? What did they wear? What did they say? You know, what did they look like? Everything.
I don't think we even knew exactly what it was that we were yearning for, whether you were crying for it or whether you were screaming for it. What you wanted was some kind of a connection with these men, and I think we didn't recognize it, but it was a sexual connection.
Well, they were pretty darn good looking, I gotta say that. And I was certainly smitten with Paul at the time, but they were very handsome young men.
The Beatles were good looking, I suppose, but I don't know, when one started screaming, they all did. It's even a problem here at the studio.
For the entire concert, I never heard a melody line. I never heard a clear word.
It was hot. It was electric. It was magic. Everybody was screaming. Everybody was completely, completely nervous. And many of them passed out, fainted. They were carried out. And when those seats vacated, we hopped on them.
It was almost too frenzied. People were divided. They were either weepers or screamers. And I was a weeper, which meant I resented the screamers, because with so much screaming going on, how could you hear the beloved if everyone was screaming like that? And so I was a little resentful of all the screaming going on. But that screaming created a kind of a very strange atmosphere, because really that is all that you could hear, was the screaming. So there was a kind of mass hysteria that comes out of that screaming. And I just sat there and quietly wept.
Atmosphere of being sort of on a runway with a jet plane taking off, the sound of it, and just the excitement of, and people, the girls screaming, jumping all over the place.
I got sort of shivers and a weird feeling in the back of my neck, and it was almost like one of fear, because it was so powerful.
I don't think anyone had seen young people making that amount of noise and screaming and yelling, and just, it was just really a din.
After the concert, Beatles had left, and we were in the room by ourselves, so we took
napkins,
souvenirs.
Cornflakes, boxes,
empty bottles. We just took souvenirs of the room, and
cigarette butts.
Then we were rejected, so we had to leave. But it was really, all in all, the most incredible time two teenager girls could ever have in their life.
From now until midnight tonight, we're on our party, and I know you're listening all over America, all over Canada, and it's really great. Now, at 9:30 tonight, a special Beatles segment that we have every Saturday.
It was pandemonium.
Excuse me for a moment. What's that, sweetheart?
The air, it was just filled with so much excitement.
Where do you come from? I know, sweetheart. You love the Beatles, you love... I know you don't. Woo!
New York agent and promoter Sid Bernstein had proven to be a visionary when it came to the Beatles' early career. Bernstein had promoted the foursome's Carnegie Hall show, but the following year he had something much bigger in mind, an outdoor concert at New York's cavernous Shea Stadium. Beatles manager Brian Epstein was initially skeptical.
He says, do you think we could fill that set? I'm a little worried about it. I said, I'll give you $10 for every empty seat. He says, really? I says, you get $10 for every empty seat in that stadium. Of course, the seats were full and we turned thousands of kids away.
I had just turned 15 years old, and me and four of my friends had gotten one of our dads to drive us down from Westchester County to Shea Stadium, a very big event in our lives.
And I sat up there right behind home plate with a direct view to second base in one of the first two rows. I was here both concerts.
Everybody was, the whole stadium was alive. It was like it was moving.
So she was sitting directly next to me, and yet she could not hear a word that I said.
And the noise My friends told me they could hear it in the Bronx.
When they came on the field, the din was just unbelievable.
They took the stage, and it was magic.
The screaming was so loud that you couldn't hear the music. But as people tell me now, some 25, 30 years later, who meet me and tell me they were at Shea Stadium, I said, did you hear anything? And they invariably say, we were there. That's all that mattered. And that's all that did matter. John Lennon said to me, you know, Sid, at Shea Stadium, I saw the top of the mountain. I said, you know, John, so did I.
During the years of the British invasion, the Beatles weren't the only band to be confronted by masses of screaming, hysterical fans. Similar displays of manic affection were also being experienced by groups like the Rolling Stones, the Dave Clark Five, and Herman's Hermits, fronted by their youthful singer, Peter Noon.
I think what happened in that 1963 period when the Beatles came on, suddenly some of the audience became younger. And that was, I mean, for Elvis Presley and the Beatles, they were, and Frank Sinatra, they were much older people. And what happened, suddenly 13-year-old girls had all this freedom. I think the real reason is that there were a lot, it was kind of safe. And it was fun. Their parents had tasted it a little bit, and it had been fun and safe for them, so they figured, you know, when you think the Beatles did that show at Shea Stadium, now who would drop their kids off at Shea Stadium nowadays? You wouldn't even think about it. Or Maple Leaf Gardens. You would go, nah, you know what, I'll come to the show with you. Now if you go and see NSYNC, any teen adults from now, they've all got their parents with them or waiting outside because kids aren't safe. You were really safe in the 60s. So all the teen idols got the best of it because we had little girls running around afterwards, after us, without their parents.
Herman's Hermits were greeted with their fair share of fan hysteria as they toured America. Does Peter recall the first time that the full force of this wave of teen adoration came crashing over them?
I remember it vividly. And he announces, he goes, ladies and gentlemen, they're here, and the audience was really noisy. And they announced us, and the whole audience joined us on stage and took all our gear and all our clothes, and we were kind of bewildered. We were, like, so naive because we had, you know, in those days, I don't know if you remember, but once upon a time, if a policeman went like this, everybody would stop out of kind of respect. Dave ran over this guy. He just blasted him on the floor. He was like, oh, like a cartoon. And they all came on the stage and we go, no, no, no. You know, instead of going, let's get out of here, we were like protecting the gear. No, you can't have that. You can't have my tie. No, no.
He's their teen idol. You know, he just, you know, when you idolize somebody from, you know, for over 30 years, they just get better all the time.
You know, it was unusual back in 1965, 66. There was no really big network variety show geared for young people.
Music for teens on television back in the mid-60s was limited to American Bandstand, Shindig, The Ed Sullivan Show, and Hullabaloo.
The thing about Hullabaloo was that it was the first show that on television, it was the marriage of sort of your variety show format, where a name host, not necessarily even a young recording artist, could mix with the young people, the record acts. It's kind of interesting about young people's tastes on television. The minute the show became popular with everybody, the young people stopped watching it. The young people kind of like shows that are their shows.
Here we come, walk down the street. We get the funniest looks from everyone we meet. Hey, hey, we're the Monkees, and people say we monkey around.
Going to audition for a Mr. Russell.
Hey, you're putting us on.
The auditions were extensive. They went on for months. It was the longest audition process I'd ever been in.
If you think I'm a goof, man, I'm a goof. You know, what I think is what I am, right? So I don't think I'm a goof.
I don't think you're a goof.
Right, okay. I think I'm out of work.
I think I kind of like tall girls, yeah. It's kind of groovy, but...
Well, no, I didn't ask you that, David.
Yeah.
I asked you whether or not they like you.
Well, John Lennon was the first one to make that comparison. He said the Monkees are like the Marx Brothers. They're not like the Beatles at all. They're like the Marx Brothers. And he was absolutely right. We came along when the Beatles had gone on and become adult more and become more sophisticated in their music and their sensibilities. And they took their fans with them. And our fans were the young... We weren't in competition with the Beatles at all. Everybody made this big Beatle-Monkey comparison, but there really wasn't the same fan at all. We got the younger sisters.
Younger sisters or not, they had obviously inherited some of their older sisters' scream genes.
I walk in through these big double doors, this mall I'd been in a million times. All of a sudden, I hear a bunch of screaming and people running at me, and I thought, oh, shit, there's a fire! And I thought, oh, and I turned her and I ran out, you know, opened the door and ran outside, and I turned back around to look and see where the fire was, and they're still screaming and still running at me. And it was a whole bunch of little girls that were on the mall on a Saturday, and I went, oh, it's me! Oh, my God! We went out, we played every note, we sang the hit songs, we had this huge tour. And at that point, I guess this imaginary act, you know, came alive, you know, by magic. Run off stage, get in a car, and go, because we didn't, you know, because it's too dangerous to stay around, but some kids must have seen where we were. And I remember sitting in a limo, you know, we just pulled away, and I went, whew, that was close. And I turn around to look, and there's a girl hanging on the back of the car like this, Mika, Mika. And the driver didn't know, and I turn around and go, there's a girl on the... And he just takes a corner, and this girl just goes, yeah!
We used to take them down to the studio, and when they were filming, and Head, you know, that they did their film. But when it was ever recorded, you know, there's always massive crowds outside.
And I was more frightened for what would happen to other people, because we were pretty well protected.
Monkey mania.
When we return, the wild world of teen obsession. Who's pulling the strings?
You're watching Neo Hot Summer Nights. All music, all month.
I took her to a Backstreet Boys concert, first concert ever. It was awesome, just being around 50,000 screaming young girls. It was just incredible. It didn't matter that we were way up high. You could feel the excitement and the rush. It was just awesome. It carried you away. And I screamed with her.
What is it that makes outwardly sane and civilly young ladies turn into howling banshees in the presence of friends, fellow fanatics, and the boy of their dreams?
I think it's the idea that... you know, you're in concert, you're in the same room as the person, you know, whose pictures are adorning your walls, and you think, I'm really, for once, have some physical proximity to this person, and it's so exciting, it's such an adrenaline rush. You're at the age where your hormones are going crazy anyway.
They're just getting into wanting to be adults. They're not quite there yet, but there's a lot of peer involvement. And they can't do things real in the real world, so they're going to do it in their fantasy world.
I think the fantasy, more than anything else, is important to these girls. And, you know, what's interesting is that the teen idols they focus on are not particularly masculine in terms of, the way someone like a George Clooney is. There's not a lot of facial hair. There's not a lot of body hair. I mean, these are really young boys who are, you know, very non-threatening. You know, it's much more, fun to have a crush on someone like a Justin Timberlake or a Kevin Richardson than, you know, the smelly kid who's sort of sitting next to you in math class, you know.
When the artist is actually in the room with you, even if it's with 6,000 other people, it's really surreal. It becomes this fantasy. It's almost conceivable that that guitarist is going to look at us and say, you.
I always say I'm
not gonna scream. Yeah. But I do. I heard you. I always say I'm not gonna scream.
Yes, you do.
But I do.
I've heard you.
And it's like not one of those things when you're at a concert where you're all, everyone's waving and they wave back and you're like, oh, he waved at me. Like, now you know that, like, he actually waved to us.
We were like, because
it was just us.
And all of a sudden you think, oh my God, I could really reach out and touch this person. You know, hence, you know, all those famous pictures of, you know, Beatles fans, you know, with their arms outstretched, whether it's on Ed Sullivan or at Shea Stadium. Because they think that they're just physically trying to get close to their idols, and it's just very exciting.
And the fantasy is, you know, you're going to go and get married and live happily ever after. I mean, that's really the fantasy of the whole teen idol thing.
And I think also part of it is that you just get swept up in the excitement of, you know, everyone else screaming, so you want to start screaming too. It's almost like being on a roller coaster.
There's been a lot of research done that has proven that female babies, starting from infancy, are very audio. They're very into the sound of things.
I think it's just like a natural reaction.
It's an emotional outlet. It's a catharsis because they're seeing the people that they love, so they just scream and it's shout out their love.
It's a sign of affection.
Sign of affection. Yeah. Very good.
I think it's just an excitement that builds and builds and builds there. They see a picture monthly, and then they see you on TV, and to them, you're an icon.
Like, at that moment, I couldn't, like, think. I was like, this is an awesome concert. And I, like, almost cried. Like, I never have ever, like, cried for boy bands.
They always make fun of people who
cry. I know.
She's
always like,
she's like, so stupid.
People yeah, it's like, they're why would you cry?
There is something about the female psyche that leads them to want to attach themselves to a guru. They want to become a disciple of somebody.
To meet them, I want to meet them. I'm going to their concerts. It's like, I was one of those people. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to meet them. I'm going to get a hug. I'm going to meet them.
This whole idea of these guys and they portray something here for these girls, I think. They get caught up in the love kind of fantasy.
And when, in fact, they do see you live performing on stage or they meet you somewhere, they cannot hold, they cannot hold back.
They play to this play in many ways, to the attitudes, the emotions of these girls at this age.
Well, the early teen years for girls are the age of sexual awakening. And the phenomenon of attaching yourself to a pop idol is partly a means of locating your target and freeing yourself from parental control.
I call him my boyfriend. Since I don't have a real boyfriend, I'm like, this is my boyfriend. Because really, it's like watching him like on Making the Band or reading stuff about him, it's like, that's the kind of boyfriend I want that.
Because young girls will grow up initially, usually attached to their father, and they've got to in some way break loose, and the teenage rebellion represents that breaking free to find a new male partner.
For all of the analysis of what goes on in the mind of a teenage girl, when it comes to their favorite pop stars, you have to look no further than the racks of teen magazines that abound, where special issues devoted to the latest heartthrob sends the circulation figures soaring. Within the pages of these magazines lies the stuff of which dreams are made.
Those kind of things happen just because of the culture, and I think our culture sort of gravitates towards it because it's so instantaneous. It's like, oh, pictures and posters and...
The basic appeal of the magazines is that you're getting posters and pinups of teen idols, you know, that you can rip out and put on your bedroom wall or your locker and pass around to your friends. It's really the whole idea of the fantasy behind these teen idols to say, wow, you know, maybe I could go out with him and he could be my boyfriend. Not husband, boyfriend.
You have to put yourself into the mind of a 14-year-old girl, really, and think, what would they want to know? Obviously, there will be stuff about what's your ideal girlfriend, have you got a girlfriend, but they do want to know what's your perfect girl like, and where would you take them on a date? But they want to know everything about their lives, really. We'll, like, go to their houses, we'll go to their bedrooms if we can, as the readers would want to.
Well, when the teen magazines came rolling through the system, wanted to know every little thing about me, how even Meryl Osmond kisses. We know what
girls like. They like to... Teen magazines are more important, though.
Come on.
Oh, my God.
I mean, who cares about the New York Times? I mean, nobody reads that.
They come after you and have phony dates with people and take pictures with an elephant and, you know, anything. just anything.
One thing we always talk about is that you can always tell how old somebody is by the band that they associate Tiger Beat or Teen Beat with. They'll say, oh, of course, you know, Leif Garrett, I had his picture all over my bedroom wall, so you know that that person grew up at a certain time versus someone who was reading it for Herman's Hermits or the Monkees or Paul Revere and the Raiders.
Pop magazines were the major promotional tool for a music industry that was increasingly targeting teen girls for their products until the 60s, when after-school shows like Where the Action Is, featuring Paul Revere and the Raiders, took to the air.
By then, we were wearing the colonial costumes, and the British music invasion was happening, and come on, with a name like Paul Revere and the Raiders, you know, it was made in heaven. Television is just unbelievable power. All of a sudden, there was kids all over America that became aware of Paul Revere and the Raiders, and they were writing the individual guys in the group, and the fan mail started heaping up at Dick Clark's office. And
Van Sant was the main show that we were on, and when we were on that, the reaction was incredible. We would go up to the management office, which was Tiger Beat, and they'd say, here's your mail. And it was literally canvas bags from the U.S. Postal Service that was maybe 16 full bags, 3 feet high, and it was like, take this home. It was like, you need a van to bring that stuff home.
Teen magazines just became huge, and primarily because of, well, two things. One, the Beatles, when they hit, the kids could not get enough information or enough pictures. That was, and then when Where the Action Is came on the air, then all of a sudden, all the groups in the country got to be seen on television.
The teen magazines, you know, filled a niche, and you needed them, they needed you. Very powerful back then. Gloria Stavers was a huge influence. It wasn't that they could control the industry, but they could decide, you know, who they wanted to put on their covers and who they didn't, you know. So I couldn't tell you what went on behind the scenes. I dread to think.
In the late 50s, 16 magazine was one of the first major teen publications devoted to pop stars to hit the stands. Gloria Stavers, a former New York model, became the publication's editor-in-chief in 1958, and over the next two decades, she became one of the most influential media people in the music world. She wrote most of the articles and interviews in 16 and was its principal photographer, but most impressive was her eye for talent and the next big thing.
But Gloria was, she decided that Herman was going to be the teen idol of the 60s. And she told me when I was over, she said, you're over, Jim Morrison. She was actually a very, very good friend. But she said, you know, you're going to be it, so what we're going to do is we're going to... And I said, well, I don't really think... She said, you don't need to worry. I'll change anything that you say wrong and make you look good.
Really, she was the, you know, genius behind 16. She was very smart because I've read some of the issues that she edited and that she very much made herself a personality within the pages.
She wasn't just some broad, you know, just sitting there trying to make a living and, oh, well, yeah, this guy's going to be the next maybe or something here. No, she was genuinely, you know, into it.
So when kids wrote in a letter to the editor, she certainly made you feel in the pages like she was personally reading it and personally answering. From what I understand, she also had really great relationships with the bands that she covered.
She was very attractive as a person, you know, very, very tough, and she had a cigarette and, you know, her cameras, and she had, you stand there. It was great, the Hermits, like these rebel guys in the Hermits, were like, oh, okay, here. Put my hand like this.
And everybody from the Beatles and the Rolling Stones, you know, knew who Gloria Stavers was, in addition to the readers of 16.
She ran the business in those days. If she liked you, you would make it in America.
For some reason, she latched onto me and had a thing for me, you know, and was very, very, very supportive and, you know, and put me in all these magazines with my pants undone. And she said she wanted to push the envelope, you know, to see how far she could go with all these teen magazines, and I was, you know, very willing, very, very, very willing pop star.
During most of the darkest periods in history, people have turned to music and the entertainment world in general to take their minds off the hard times at hand, even for a short while. So it was with America as the Second World War raged on across an ocean suddenly less wide, less dividing than before. It was the era of the big bands, of Benny Goodman, Glenn Miller, and Tommy Dorsey, of dances like the Lindy and the Jitterbug, and of crooners like Frank Sinatra.
You're always going to have young girls who want an imaginary boyfriend. That's always going to happen. My sister, when she was 12, she loved Frank Sinatra.
The whole, like, screaming hysteria thing was Frank Sinatra was probably one of the first.
Frank Sinatra was the unlikeliest of pop icons, a skinny Italian kid from Hoboken, New Jersey, whose velvet-toned voice made the teenage girls of the day faint dead away. Sure, Bing Crosby and Rudy Valley had also made them swoon, but in the decade following World War II, Sinatra took the hysteria to a new level.
I guess I was first aware of that screaming phenomenon at the New York City Paramount in 42 for Sinatra. And it was amazing that the little girls would collect, and the minute he appeared, that at first there would be, you know, just a couple, and then all of a sudden it would be a swell, and it was everybody.
The surprise over the hysterical reaction Sinatra received from his fans was evident in the bewildered press reports following his live appearances, like this dispatch from the New York correspondent for the UK's Guardian newspaper in 1945.
Mr. Frank Sinatra, an amiable young singer of popular songs, is inspiring extraordinary personal devotion on the part of many thousands of young people, and particularly young girls between the ages of, say, 12 and 18. Psychologists have written soberly about the hypnotic quality of his voice and the remarkable effect upon susceptible young women. The teenage girls who constitute the main part of his audience also wear white half hose and are therefore called Bobby Soxers.
We call ourselves Bobby Soxers, absolutely. Yeah, and that was the rage at that time.
And they'd like to get around that stage door and see their idol and scream. And that same principle followed through with Sinatra and with all the teen idols that came after Sinatra.
The screams and squeals of the Bobby Soxers were silenced by the 50s as Frank Sinatra began to lose his teen appeal. But it wasn't long before the vacuum was filled by a young hip swiveler from Tupelo, Mississippi, by the name of Elvis Presley.
He got the whole audience. Elvis got the males as well as the females, because you have to remember when Elvis finally happened, that look, that whole, it was part of the rebellion period in the 50s.
See, I really think he was just one of a kind. Loved what he did, and he did it very, very well. But he was just the right person for the time.
He's fabulous.
Fabulous?
Fabulous. He's a king.
What do you think of Elvis?
Great.
Is that all just great?
No. It's everything.
No, Elvis, you heard the stories of, you know, the people that were trying to shoot him for wiggling his hips. Well, the bottom line is that it's an extremely sexual phenomenon.
He was, when you think about the times and what the 50s were like and what Elvis was like. Probably in terms of sex, Elvis really did break a mold.
People like Sinatra, Presley, the Beatles, those guys, because they had the talent and because their careers had longevity and they were able to reinvent themselves, all of them, managed to survive.
Behind most of the teen idols over the years, there have been a variety of colorful characters, mentors, visionaries, and flim-flam men who have taken care of the backroom business. For Elvis, a savvy huckster by the name of Colonel Tom Parker was the man with the plan.
Elvis would never have happened the way he did wasn't for the Colonel. That was a great match. Elvis would be announced at the Hilton. He bought out all the billboards in the Las Vegas, Clark County area. We had a political election coming up, and there were no billboards. The Colonel resold the billboards to the politicians for the length of the election period and made a nice profit.
Women don't want the blonde singing idols. They want dark hair. They like dark hair.
He's the voice behind the voice.
Listen, I'm looking for somebody good to record my stuff, and I think you're it.
The face behind the face.
The business needs a new teen idol, and Tommy's the one.
The mind behind the fantasies of millions.
I need a star. I need a real star. Somebody who's bigger than life.
He's the idol maker.
Well, because I love music, and at one point I thought maybe I could be an idol or a singer,
until I woke up and looked in the mirror and said, Marcucci, I don't think you have the looks to be an idol, no matter who manages you. So I decided to be behind the scenes and find that look, that charisma, that quality, that look. That was it. What is it they had that the kid would go crazy for? Didn't think a blonde, blue-eyed kid make it that day. It was always that dark look. But then all of a sudden, Ricky Nelson came out and Elvis Presley. Though they were not blonde, blue-eyed, their features were very structured. They were very waspish looking and very handsome.
People call me a teenage idol. Some people say they envy me. I guess they got no way of knowing how lonesome I can be.
The first teen star to get a major boost from a weekly TV series was Ricky Nelson, a member of the cast of the hit TV series The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. The story goes that Ricky's singing career began after his girlfriend became a big Elvis Presley fan. It was a case of anything you can do, I can do better. Frankie Avalon, Bob Marcucci's first discovery, was an accomplished trumpet player with a major recording contract under his belt when he was convinced to broaden his showbiz outlook as a singer and actor. In the wake of a series of popular surf and sand movies and a number of hit singles, Frankie Avalon soon became a certified American pop icon.
And that's when I discovered Fabian, because I thought Fabian was in the same genre as Ricky and Elvis. And then, thank God, Elvis went in the Army. I may have never been sitting here talking to you right now.
I remember meeting Fabian when he was 15 years old. Bob brought him to the Little Theater, Dick Clark's Little Theater, for one of the Saturday night shows that Frankie Avalon was performing on, and the Diamonds as well. And I remember meeting him as a young kid. I have great admiration for him. Of all of the people I know in show business, he's probably the only person that show business chose.
I never wanted to be in it. And if showbiz found me, I'm of course it did me a favor, because my whole reason for being in show business was to help my family that period.
You know, there he was sitting on his porch or whatever, and Bob Marcucci, on his way to Frankie Avalon's house, saw him sitting there and asked Frankie who that kid was.
I met Marcucci on my doorstep. I was 14, 14 and a half years old.
Every day I would drive by his house, and he was working for a drugstore. And every day he looked more and more like the look. One day I knocked on his door and asked him to come over and sing a song for me. And his mother asked who it was, and she says, that crazy man who's a friend of our neighbors. And she said, well, you gotta be respectful, go with that crazy man. We heard him, but he wasn't the greatest singer, but he had his heart into it and did a nice job. And we recorded him, and the rest is history with him.
My first traumatic experience with girls screaming at me was at a record hop in Philadelphia. And I was nervous and scared, and they had me in white buck shoes, and they had me in these tight pants and a sweater. I wasn't hot enough, but they put me in a sweater. And I walk on stage, and this overwhelming scream almost sounded like it was in unison. And I was shocked. I was scared. I didn't know what I did wrong. I didn't know what was going on. It was an out-of-body experience.
Like Frankie Avalon and Ricky Nelson, Fabian's clean-cut, all-American boy image was embraced by the traditional white music establishment in the face of the growing popularity of the dreaded rock and roll. As artists, they were non-threatening and gave the hordes of loyal teen fans at home and abroad the dance beat they craved.
Oh, Australia, they had to get me off the plane in a forklift. 10,000 people showed up at the airport. It was absolutely amazing, and my fans were wonderful. I mean, they were great to me. Your relationship with your fans is they look at you, and if you look back at them, like you care about them, really care about them, they're with you for life.
We want Paul! We want Paul! We want Paul!
We don't want no one hurt now. We want everyone to stay nice.
He's so nice. Oh, I love him.
Put your head on my shoulder.
In 1957, Paul Anka became one of the first international teen idols of the rock era when, ironically, a crush on his babysitter resulted in the chart-topping song Diana, one of the biggest-selling pop singles of all time. Anka had a string of hits over the next decade, including Lonely Boy, You Are My Destiny, and Put Your Head on My Shoulder.
Probably very few 13-year-olds with good voices, actually. Mine was terrible. It was a lot of emotion, and I was just a nice, squeaky little teenager with some appeal and got very lucky.
In those early years, as Anka experienced the unbridled adoration of his fans, he was under no illusion as to what was causing all the fuss.
Can't win.
I would say 60% of it is on emotion and a word which we all know and I'm not in accord to using, but it's the only word which can sum up what I have to say, which is sex.
Put your head on my shoulder.
As far as the girls who turn out and scream, which is what you mean, and stand there and cry and things like that, kind of feel if I'm singing like a lonely boy, they like to feel, well, they're the girl that I'm singing about.
Put your head on.
When I started off, I mean, the screaming, it was, I mean, who wouldn't love it, you know? I was just on cloud nine, and of course, being Italian,
tell fortune.
Another young crooner to make his presence felt on the charts and in the hearts of many a teen girl in the early 60s was Bobby Curtola. Bobby, who certainly had the image and musical credentials to qualify him as a teen star, was destined to make his mark on the music world internationally. It was quite an adventure for a kid who was still in high school while his songs were climbing the pop charts.
When the records started to work, every weekend we'd be on the airplane going to the places that were playing our records, and we'd go in for the concerts and shows, and by 1964 it'd flown over a million miles. Every weekend we were somewhere, and fly back for the Monday going back to school, you know?
Everybody wanted to be Bobby's girl. And Bobby used to go around singing, I want to be Bobby's girl. They all wanted to know what everybody looked like, I guess, to see what their competition was.
When you're a fan of the music, which most singers are fans of the music, all of a sudden you find yourself in the dream and standing on the corner of Hollywood and Vine and saying, but I'm really doing this, you know, in the Photoplay magazine, in the Look, I mean, in the Weekend magazine. I mean, all of a sudden, there you are. The dreams are actually happening.
All these girls were all thinking they were going to be the Mrs. Curtola. So one was actually buying wedding dresses. And it was, everybody was in love with Bobby. He made everybody feel special. He had a knack of making everyone feel special, and he sang just for you.
The hormones were working. I was more excited than they were, I think. I used to tell all the girls years later, said, you don't know how many times you were responsible for that cold shower of mine, you know.
I just loved them. When they came on telly, I'd go, funny.
Next, screaming for the Tartan Army.
You are watching Summer Nights, all music, all month.
I can remember them being the first band that I loved, and I had tartan trousers, and my brother came down to London and bought me a little baby Bay City Rollers t-shirt, and I just loved them. When they came on telly, I'd go, funny.
Not exactly another British invasion, the Bay City Rollers, five tartan-wearing lads from Scotland, nonetheless caused quite a stir in America, where fans wore Argyle socks to match the pattern of those worn by their favorite group member.
The fans in America were great. I mean, they really did welcome us with open arms. I think, I'm not sure if it was our little Scottish kilts that turned them on, or I'm not sure. Why did you write me and tell me? I don't know, they seemed to love our accents, loved the way we dressed, loved our songs. They just loved us. We were loved by a nation. It was great. By the whole world at one point. Hey.
Saturday night, Saturday night. It's just a Saturday night.
There was one time, for instance, in Mallory Park. It's a racing circuit here in England. And there was cars, Formula 2 or something, bombing around the track, full speed. We came in on helicopter, James Bond style, you know. Comes down, comes to the BBC or wherever it was, Radio Shack, and we're going to be interviewed in there. But 30,000 kids start running across the track with all these cars running past it. God, that was that, those kind of things were dangerous and crazy. But yeah, scary things. The fans did scary things like that. They threw caution to the wind. In the 70s were a great time in history, and the music and fashion then, a lot of people have a laugh at it, but I think it was great.
You know, back in the 70s, it was just like a whirlwind.
Those were marvelous days. They really were.
When you're a 16, 17-year-old kid and you want to go on a date, there's 15,000 of them sitting out there screaming for you, it does get your attention.
That's no job.
My cousin, who didn't live too far away from where I was staying, I begged him and begged him. I said, please take me to the airport. I've got to see these guys come in, you know, because I love Tony Osmond. I've got to go.
In England, we used to have these paddy wagons that used to be right there, and we used to jump in the paddy wagons, and the girls would come around. It was just like a sea of faces.
We arrived at the airport, and there was just thousands of girls, and he just stopped the car and said, right, out you get. I'm not going any further. I can't handle this. So he just left me there in the middle of the airport. I hadn't been there very long when this group of girls came up to me. I hadn't seen them before. I didn't know who they were. And they came up to me and they said, are you on your own? And I said, yes, I am. And they said, oh, we're just about to go into a taxi to the Churchill Hotel because we know the Osmonds are staying there.
Well, the Churchill Hotel, first of all, they took an axe to the main door. The fans took a literal axe to the door.
And we went underneath the, they have an underground parking. And these girls just came down and they tried to get them out with hoses and things like that, but there was a girl hiding around the corner, and she threw her arm around the door, around my neck, and got me into a neck lock. And then my mother saw it, but she physically grabbed her arm and just lifted her up like this. I mean, you know, you do amazing things when you have adrenaline. So my mother saved my life that night.
And there was already a load of people up there, so we joined them, and of course we started to sing. We went Donny, we went Donny. And periodically then he'd stick his head out. We'd all go, ah, Donny, Donny, you know, crazy.
The Osmonds' first hit single was One Bad Apple, which topped the charts in 1971. Not only did it launch Donny Osmond's solo career, but it also marked the beginning of a new and initially disconcerting concert experience for all of them.
Well, I remember that first impact. It was in Cleveland, Ohio. It was right after we had the record One Bad Apple. And we go out with the lights off, completely shut the everything off.
So we move out on the stage, and we had no idea that we were going to receive screams.
We're up there, and we start looking at each other. We're playing. Nobody can even hear what we're playing.
I don't think my brothers and I really bought into too much of it, though. We had our life, you know. We were like in a little bubble. And to break that bubble was impossible. So when we saw all the teenage craziness going on around us, it was okay. We accepted it for what it was. But when we came home, that little bubble was very soft, very secure.
I'm not ashamed to tell the world that you really messed up my mind. Go to me, you're like...
It was the Churchill where our buddies, the Jacksons, showed up as well. So they took one wing of the hotel. We took the other wing, but I remember going, all the Osmonds marching down to their floor and knocking on the door, and the door opens and there the Jacksons are all sitting around the place.
Michael told us that one that he used to have to sit in front of a television set with his brothers. His father made him do that and watch us on the Andy Williams Show.
The Jackson 5, with young brother Michael doing most of the singing, had their first four singles go to number one in 1970. That was a first for any group, and only just a hint, as it turns out, of the enormous success that was waiting in the wings for Michael Jackson.
You don't know? The Jackson 5.
That's us.
And that's no job.
As the undisputed king of pop over the last three decades of the 20th century, he left teen idoldom behind and became one of the most successful recording artists of all time. Another chart-topping group during the period was the DeFranco family, featuring 13-year-old Tony DeFranco.
A gentleman was traveling through Canada, saw us perform at a, I think it was a park. And he approached my father and said, you know what, I can do wonders with your family. Please let me take photos. Please, let's do some demos. Let's send that to Hollywood, to New York. And he did it. And, you know, we were flown out to Hollywood by the publisher of Tiger Beat magazine. And he loved the look, and we hired a producer. And probably 6 months to a year later, we were at the top of the charts. It's a love beat.
Ask any artist about memorable moments in their career, and one of the things they'll tell you about is the first time they heard themselves on the radio.
That's a running joke, because I was in the restroom, and my family was screaming, "It's on, it's on." I'm like, "What's on? The song's on the radio." So I'm trying to get out of the door, and the door was a sliding door, and it was jammed, and I couldn't get it open, and everybody was just laughing at me. And then 2 days later, we were driving down Ventura Boulevard, and we hear it on the radio, and we're screaming, we're singing along, we're having a blast. We change stations, it's on another station. We're singing, we're having a blast, we change stations, it's on a third station. It was just a magic carpet ride. It was a lot of fun.
Their time in the sun was brief, but as the DeFranco family hit the road for a concert tour, they got their first taste of the extent to which fans will go to get close to their idols.
It was like the flood of the dam when it breaks. It took one girl to rush the stage. She gets on there, grabs me, wouldn't let go. A couple more brave girls do it. They jump on stage. Security's running to grab them. Next thing you know, the stage was overrun. We're being grabbed and pulled. Security grabs us, runs us backstage. We're being chased by these girls backstage through the hallways. We end up in the locker room or the dressing room, and they're pounding on the door, screaming for us. When all of the smoke cleared, our bus was damaged and written on in lipstick. The stage doors were broken. It was total chaos.
Barry Williams was 14 years old and already a veteran child actor when he joined the cast of the Brady Bunch as Greg Brady.
After we'd released our first album or two, we started to do personal appearances and to go out on concert tour, and we were going into the heartland of America. That's when we really got our first taste of impact, of fans, of excitement, of people, of the mix and music, and it was very exciting.
The Brady Bunch series would spawn a number of recordings which took the cast from the two-dimensional world of television to the unpredictability of getting up close and personal with the fans.
But sometimes crowd mentality can get a little out of hand. It's synergistic. It keeps going. It grows and it grows. And sometimes it gets out of control. And so a group of kids were looking for us. And I think it was kind of a game for them. And they thought they had us tracked down to this Winnebago that we were using as a dressing room behind the stage. And they were saying, "Come on out, get out, get out, get out." And we weren't in there. And they started rocking it and rocking it. And, you know, and then that became more of a game. And then they knocked it over. I thought, okay, glad we weren't there.
First the Brady Bunch, which gets you pumped because there were three guys, not all hot. And then the Partridge Family came on, and it was the music, and it was the group. And I always loved David Cassidy, but I had an older sister, so I had to secretly like David Cassidy because I was had to like Danny because she liked David. But we just really got into the Partridge Family and the music, and we had the albums, and every time a new album, vinyl, came out, we had to get it and play it and sing, and we were all into music on my street and my friends, and we were just, the Partridge Family was it. The magazine Tiger Beat, we'd have a spare room, and we'd plaster the walls with all the Tiger Beat pictures, mostly David Cassidy, a few Bobby Sherman, a few monkeys, but it was David Cassidy. I mean, he was the man, and it was just totally awesome. You know, Friday night, that was it. You know, no parties, no anything. You were in front of the TV and singing along with the Partridge Family.
The Partridge Family TV show not only made a major pop star of David Cassidy, the family group itself also piqued the imagination of a generation of would-be singers and musicians.
David Cassidy was my favorite. Partridge Family, when I was little. We used to pretend we were the Partridge Family when we were kids and all had your boxes and you know, play music and act silly, and you always had to be the star, right? Singing along with the music. It was really cool.
I think I love you.
Sass Jordan, who is not only a successful recording artist in her own right, has also recorded with a number of other acts, including Carlos Santana. Her duet with Joe Cocker appeared on the Bodyguard CD, one of the biggest-selling soundtrack albums of all time.
It was the very first time I had any exposure to the idea of life on the road. Of course, it was an extremely Hollywood version of life on the road, as I now know. But at the time, it just, you know, it was like, come on, let's get happy or whatever, as opposed to a drug anthem. It was actually the idea of bringing joy, singing, laughter, fun, you know, to people in different cities. And they all traveled together on this bus. I mean, it was an amazing thing, you know, to see this. And I remember distinctly seeing it and going, that's what I'm going to do when I grow up. So years later, I'm living in Los Angeles making my second record, and the producer of the record said he was going to bring me a present that I could not possibly imagine what it is to my birthday dinner, and doesn't he show up with Keith Partridge? He walked in, and every single one of them went, oh, Keith!
Where I would go in the 70s, it was real, genuine hysteria. And that can be scary.
The manager of the hotel said, there he goes. I said, what? They go, there he goes. I said, where? Where? Where'd he go? And I'm like, okay, okay. So I grab my program, and I run to the elevator in the hotel, and I was going, oh, my God, oh, my God. And I stop and say, oh, my God, oh, my God, I need your autograph. Can I have a hug? Can I have an autograph? And I was like, this poor guy who's just, like, looked at me and says, okay, you know, it's fine. So
it's just people's response and reaction to me everywhere I went was, it was such pandemonium and madness.
We were the last of the solo teen idols. It was like me, David, Sean, and Andy Gibb, and Rex Smith, maybe, you know. We're the last of the solo idols.
Leif Garrett's new group, Fate, includes drummer Chuck Billings, who has toured with Sean Cassidy and as a member of the teen scream group, Virgin. He'll never forget the group's first experience facing an arena full of hysterical, screaming fans.
Our first show was at the Salt Palace in Salt Lake City, and it was a 20,000-seater. That was our first live show, and we had no clue. We had no idea, because we didn't, you know, before we'd played clubs or whatever, but we had no idea what it was going to be like. We had no idea the place was sold out. We didn't know anything. We just went to the dressing room. They said it's showtime, and the lights went off. When the lights went off, you could feel the rumble, and the whole building would almost shake with the screaming as we're coming up to get up on stage in the dark, and it scared all of us. When we first heard the screaming, we all stopped and went, wait a minute, what's going on here?
Fame is a very two-sided thing, that while most people think it would be a great thing to become famous, people who do acquire fame soon discover that it's a two-edged sword.